Hey everyone, Nathaniel Ruffeljams from Nintendo Prime, and I actually want to talk to you today about something that's been near and dear to my heart, and this is the future of the Switch platform after PlayStation 5 and the next Xbox presumably release next year. And there's been a lot of concern shown out there because of things like, is the Switch Pro real? Is the Switch revision in August what the Switch Pro is? Even if the Switch Pro is real, does it really make the Switch comparable enough to even a base PlayStation 4 and Xbox One to even like get future third-party games? And I'm not here to tell you that third-party games on Switch don't matter. I actually did make a video about how the Switch doesn't need AAA third-party games, but is obviously a better platform for having them. Getting games like The Witcher 3 this year, getting, you know, a week from now, we get Wolfenstein Youngblood, getting those kind of games on Switch does factually make Nintendo Switch a better gaming platform. So I'm not here to tell you that Switch, you know, is better off without those games. But what I am here to maybe ease your mind a little bit is why Nintendo shouldn't have to worry about what's happening with PlayStation 5 and Xbox Scarlett. At least they shouldn't have to worry about it in the near future. And I'm not just talking 2019, I'm talking 2020, I'm talking 2021. I firmly believe that Nintendo with Switch has nothing to worry about probably until, I don't know, about halfway through the PlayStation 5 and Xbox Scarlett generation. Now, I think an important thing when we talk about generations is technically Nintendo Switch is already part of that generation. Wii U was actually the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One generation, and Switch actually jump-started the current or the next gen or whatever you guys want to call it. But I get it. That's just semantics and for argument's sake on, you know, how you want to pair platforms together. I get that Nintendo Switch factually is not as strong as a base PlayStation 4 and Xbox One, and not really even that close. And you hear things today like the people behind Wolfenstein Youngblood talking about how it's basically a miracle that Panic Button could even get Youngblood on Switch, and how hard they pushed that engine, and how amazing Panic Button is by trying to get this big, massive AAA game that wouldn't otherwise be on a mobile platform like a phone running on a Nintendo Switch. And I get it. A lot of this sounds like when, you know, the PlayStation 5 and the next Xbox get here, that Switch is going to start to not get the third-party games it does get. That we might have to worry about not getting the next Mortal Kombat game after we just got Mortal Kombat 11. That we might not get the next Doom after Doom Eternal. That we might not get the next Wolfenstein after Youngblood. That, you know, any hope of Cyberpunk 2077 could be tossed out the door as the focus switches to making a PlayStation 5 and Xbox Scarlett version of that game and not really focusing on down, you know, quote-unquote downporting to get on Switch. That the next, you know, Witcher game, whether it's, you know, it'd probably be The Witcher 4 because I know they're done with the Geralt story, or Geralt, I can't remember which way it was pronounced, but they are going to be working on, you know, spin-off games, I'm sure, for that franchise eventually. And, you know, are we going to get that? Are we going to get, you know, Elder Scrolls 6 that's, you know, a next-gen game or the next Fallout? There's a lot of ands, ifs, or buts. Heck, NBA 2K that we are getting this year again for the third consecutive year, are we going to have to worry about getting NBA 2K next year? Are we going to have to worry about getting it the year after that? These are all fair questions, and I cannot sit here and look at you guys through this camera and tell you honestly that there is zero credible concern, because there is. There's obviously always going to be concern when you're talking about, you know, more powerful systems and the games being made primarily for those systems then coming to Switch. Because as it stands right now, Switch is not the first platform these companies think about when they're making these games. Now, the one caveat is Square Enix. I think the next Octopath Traveler game, obviously Switch is one of the initial platforms in consideration. I think the future of that franchise is probably pretty secure on Switch. But when we're talking about other games, like maybe getting Final Fantasy 15 or the next Final Fantasy game or something like that, the future on that is much less certain. So what I want to let you guys know is the logic I am working with here on why Nintendo's not going to have to worry about it, at least for a while. And that is because the PlayStation 5 and the next Xbox don't replace the Nintendo Switch. Let me explain. Now, the Nintendo Switch that launched back in 2017 is a neat little platform. You can dock it and play in portable or in TV mode. You can take it handheld. You can take off each Joy-Con, play sideways. It does all these little transformations, but the main brunt of it is that it's built on mobile technology, the Tegra X1. And it is a mobile platform for all intents and purposes that can be docked with your TV. The PlayStation 5, you can't just pick it up and walk out the door with it and keep playing your games. You won't be able to do that with the Xbox Scarlett either. Now, the caveat is streaming services, you know, like Project xCloud, might be able to offer some of that functionality. So streaming is one method. But if you're not into game streaming, they don't really replace Switch. It doesn't matter how powerful the box. It doesn't matter if they're 14 teraflops of performance and true 4K at 120 FPS or whatever. 8K like they touted, which, by the way, they're not going to support 8K. PC, the highest-end PC hardware can't even do 8K. So let's not even fathom the guess 8K unless they're just talking about 8K movies or something when those are starting to become more prominent. But the point is that those platforms don't actually replace what the Nintendo Switch does. Isn't that interesting? You can't just pick up the next God of War game and keep playing it on your PlayStation 5. It's just not going to be possible. So the argument isn't so much that those platforms are, you know, going to replace this. It's that because they don't replace this, that it's going to maintain its relevance for longer. Because one thing we have to remember, and we just have a recent example of this, when the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One launched, all of the games, all the multi-platform third-party games anyways, that came to those systems for the first 2.5 years of their existence, also released on PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. And some of those games are still being released on PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. I mean, MLB The Show was going to PlayStation 3 forever. So the point I'm making here is that just because these next-generation platforms exist and are out in the wild and being bought in the millions doesn't mean that the older platforms that have been out for longer are left in the dust. In fact, as long as there's a big install base that don't currently own a PlayStation 5 or an Xbox One, they keep releasing the games on those platforms. They keep making them what we, you know, dubbed this generation as cross-gen games. And I know that frustrates some people who end up owning the latest and greatest hardware, because when's everything going to stop being cross-gen, so games stop being held back? Well, there's not a lot of evidence that games are really held back, more so that the engines are that flexible, that Unreal Engine 4 is flexible enough to still run on an Xbox 360 while also bringing you the best of the best visuals on an Xbox One X. So what happened is game engines became more flexible. I don't really think there was as many sacrifices as people like to think. So my goal here is to just tell you guys that because the games are still going to be coming to PlayStation 3 and Xbox One for the next, you know, I don't know, until 2022, 2023, somewhere in there, that means all those games still have just as good of a chance as they do today of coming to Nintendo Switch. What's going to determine if third-party games leave the Switch and stop releasing on it is not going to be the PlayStation 5. It's not going to be the Xbox Scarlett. It's not even going to be Project xCloud or Google Stadia. What's going to determine when and if third-party games stop coming out on Nintendo Switch, AAA variety ones, is if we stop buying them. Guys, if we don't show up and buy games like The Witcher 3, the complete edition on Switch, we don't buy Wolfenstein Youngblood or Doom Eternal, if we stop buying NBA 2K, if we stop buying FIFA, granted, I know it's a pared back FIFA, but whatever, it's EA, you know they're going to abandon Switch as fast as they possibly can if the opportunity arises. The point I'm making here is, if we keep buying the games, buying the Diablos of the world and all that that keep coming out on the platform, the Civilization 6s, we're going to keep getting games. Because what we fail to think about when we talk about next-gen platforms and, you know, how much we need a Switch Pro to combat those platforms and all that, what we forget is that these companies exist to make money. They don't necessarily care about always having the biggest and greatest technology out there. They will bring their games to the places they think make them the most money. So if we keep showing up and buying the Mortal Kombat 11s of the world, they're going to keep bringing those games to Switch for as long as possible. And by the time they stop making these downported versions for PlayStation 3 and PlayStation 4 and Xbox One that can be then ported, you know, again over to Switch, by the time they consider to stop doing that, we'll already be talking about a Switch 2 at that point, or whatever Nintendo has coming next. Because remember, the average Nintendo life cycle is 5 to 6 years. Well, when we're in 2022 and 2023, guess where we're at? 5 to 6 years on the market, and now it's time to start talking about what's next, or even releasing that next platform. And I hope it's a Switch 2. I hope they go all out and continue with this convenient play at home and on the go form factor, especially with game streaming out there. Nintendo, you know, they claim they're acutely aware of game streaming, so this is actually a great way to combat it for people who don't want to worry about internet connections as much when they're playing their games. But that's neither here nor there. My point I'm just making is you don't need to worry about support for the Switch if you keep buying the games. That's really the bottom line. If you stop buying the games so you can play the PlayStation 5 version, so you can play the Xbox Scarlet version, that's what's going to lead to this getting less support. But if we keep showing up and keep buying it, I don't think there'll be an issue. And I think this actually has a bit more longevity out of it than, say, a PlayStation 4 and, say, an Xbox One or Xbox One X or PlayStation 4 Pro, because people already know there's a newer version of that PlayStation. There's a newer version of that Xbox that does everything that PlayStation, everything that Xbox does, has full backwards compatibility, but also gets the best looking versions of the games. Whereas if there isn't a new version of Switch, we already know when we're on the go, unless we want to use an internet connection, this is the best mobile gaming console-like experience we're going to have. And because of that, because those platforms don't actually directly replace this, believe it or not, despite the fan bickering,
believe it or not,
those systems don't even directly compete with a Switch, a PlayStation 4, and an Xbox One. They're not competing with this platform's not even attempting to compete with those. Like, yeah, it's a home console, so there's all they play video games. I guess that's as far as you say the competition goes. They're all systems that play video games, but that's like saying the 3DS was competing with, just say the 3DS could dock with a TV and output to 720p or whatever, right? Oh, the 3DS is competing with the PlayStation 3 and Xbox. No! Like, this is a mobile platform first, regardless of what Nintendo says, and because of that, it is not really in direct competition with things like the next Xbox and the next PlayStation. It's in competition with itself. Nintendo owns a hybrid market of convenience all to themselves that PlayStation used to try to do with the PSP and the Vita, and now they don't. And because nobody else is really doing it on the scale that Nintendo's doing it, they don't really need to be worried about what the competition is doing. The brilliance of what Nintendo is doing with releasing their new gen of whatever this is, mid-generation of PlayStation 5 and the next Xbox, is that they don't need to be concerned about trying to match them in power. They don't need to be concerned about matching the next generation in power. They could just keep releasing these middle-of-generation new systems moving forward that keep the ability to not be as powerful, but be significant upgrades over the prior version of those systems, so they can maintain relevance and continue to get the same kind of games they get when companies decide to stop supporting quote-unquote last-gen hardware. So the point I'm really making here is, folks, we don't need to worry about the Xbox Scarlet now. We don't need to worry about the PlayStation 5 now or even next year. Really? The only thing we need to worry about is that Nintendo keeps up every 5 to 6 years. And as long as they do that, as long as they don't really have any other competition in this space, Nintendo's going to be just fine. They're always going to get the great Nintendo games. But beyond that, I think the third-party support, why would it go anywhere when it's selling these? When Crash Team Racing has sold almost as many copies on Switch as it sold on Xbox One, why would they stop releasing Crash games on Switch just because PlayStation 5 is here? Like, that, it doesn't logically make any sense. Companies like money, and if there's money to be made, a significant margin, they're going to keep bringing games. So as long as we keep buying the games, as long as we keep wanting to play them on the go, as well as on our TV, on one single platform, without bouncing back and forth between PlayStation 5 and PC and Switch and whatever, as long as we are willing to make the sacrifices necessary to take the games with us and keep purchasing them, we're not going to need to worry about it. The thing that's going to kill third-party games on Switch is us. We are our own worst enemy. We are why third-party games would stop coming to Switch, because we would be the ones to stop buying them. Personally, I plan to keep buying AAA third-party games on Switch, even though I have other ways to play them, because this is the most convenient way for me to play them anywhere, anytime I want. Until there's something better than that, I don't think Nintendo's going to have a problem continuing to get at least the current version of AAA support that they get. So that's my thoughts on that. I actually want to know your guys' thoughts on the next gen and the future of Switch down in the comments below. There might be a lot to take in here. You know, maybe I rambled a bit too much because that's what I do. I ramble. But I really genuinely want to know your opinions on this topic. So let me know down in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, drop a like, subscribe for more content, and I'll catch every single one of you guys in the next video.